Okay, first of all, I just want to thank everybody for coming. I know that there's a lot of other things you could be doing right now, and I appreciate you showing up for resilience training. The roster is somewhere getting passed around. So I think a lot about the little things of doing training for the military. I even think about the background I have on my computer before I do class. And what movie is this from? Does anyone recognize this?
Inception.
Inception. Okay, what is the concept behind Inception? What's the whole plot of incepting?
Layers.
But what are they? What's the objective in the film?
To implant an idea.
Okay, but why can't I give you? Why can't they just say, "Hey, why don't you do this thing?" What's the principle behind implanting the idea?
Source.
Go ahead.
The idea is to make them think that they came up with the idea.
Exactly. Why is coming up with an idea on your own more powerful than another person telling you to do something? It's more meaningful. Okay, when it comes from you and comes from within, you're more driven to do it. Okay, so with all these things I do, with this class, with all my classes, with my videos, all this stuff, it's to hopefully implant an idea into you and help you make positive change for yourself. I want to thank Brian Williams for helping me come up with today's presentation. So he's a good guy. Bet you didn't know that about him. Quick favor for me. This is one of those few times when I'll say, if you want to take out your phones, either now or after the presentation, I am doing this on the civilian side. I haven't like got many paying gigs or whatnot yet, but I do this on the side. So if you want to take a look at my page after the presentation, hop on there. You'll go click that like button. You'll click 5 stars only. If you're going to click 1 star, just, you know, piss off. Don't do that at all. I hate you forever. So, again, I'll put this up at the end of the presentation, but I would appreciate it as, you know, trying to make a difference. Okay, so Hunt the Good Stuff. Who remembers or who has heard of Hunt the Good Stuff before? Okay, this is something that we've talked about before. I've taught a few classes on this. And just in case you don't remember or you're kind of a little bit rusty, let me start out by showing you the wrong way to hunt the good stuff.
The first ever prescription depressant hit the shelves today. Approved by the FDA last month, Despondex is intended as a treatment for the approximately 20 million Americans who are insufferably cheery. Tests prove the drug is effective at reducing a range of symptoms, from squealing loudly when a friend calls to use of the phrase cool beans and excessive hugging. Dr. Alman Way calls the drug a huge step forward in the battle against exuberance.
If you're in a good mood every so often, well, that's fine. That's normal. This is for those that have a persistent positive outlook on life.
Eva Henry of New Haven, Connecticut began participating in a clinical trial of Despondex 6 weeks ago.
I was always telling people how cute their outfits were and bringing them little gifts. I'd beam at anyone who made eye contact with me. I didn't realize life didn't have to be like that.
Eva said she never knew how her annoyingly chipper attitude was affecting those around her.
Over and over again, I'd ask Jeff to ride his bike down to the botanical garden with me, no matter how many times he said no.
And she was always smiling, but I didn't know what to do to help her.
I used to think, why am I the only one trying to set up single friends with each other? And now I realize it. I was sick. I needed treatment.
Eva says the drug may have saved their marriage.
Now Jeff and I can just waste a night sitting on the couch, watching a TV show neither of us enjoy. Like a regular couple.
Not everyone is convinced that Despondex is the cure-all for perkiness, however. In this week's Time magazine, Michael Pelosic of UCLA argues that many patients get similar results from natural remedies, something as simple as a diet of corn syrup and white bread and a total lack of exercise. But Dr. Way disagrees.
We have to erase the stigma attached with getting chirpy people help, real medical help. I mean, do you know what it's like to be around these people? It's pretty fucking annoying.
Doctors estimate the new drug could reduce the number of costume or theme parties in the U.S. by up to 40%.
All right, so one of the main things we want to talk about with Hunt the Good Stuff is it's going to help us build optimism. Like this young fellow right here, he's pretty optimistic about the zombies coming because, hey, he's finally going to get that girlfriend, right? You guys, like 3 magazines attached to the one? I think it's impressive. I have no idea what that even is. All right, so other than optimism, it's also going to help us build positive emotions such as gratitude. For example, a good way to be grateful is, hey, you can't get fired if you don't have a job. Positive attitudes, right? So, moving on the opposite side, it does help us counteract the negativity bias. What is negativity bias? you guys think? I mean, that picture is a pretty good example of kind of what's going on. But how do people display negativity bias in their lives, in their work, in their marriage? Sergeant Lawrence brings up a great point. In this picture, there's empty seats on this bus, right? This individual on the left has chosen to sit on that side of the bus, and he's focusing on what's outside the window, which is just the sheer wall cut in the cliff. There's empty seats on the other side. He could switch sides and look out that window. Then again, he could switch sides and keep looking out the other side, right? How else do we display negativity bias in our lives, in our relationships? Those of you who are parents probably do this once in a while, especially if your kid plays Little League like mine does. You know how patient I am. I'll get something out of you. What was that?
Comments.
What do you mean? Absolutely. Go ahead. What do you guys think? Is it something that, like, you wish you could have done something better? Is that what you're saying? Okay, so you can say, well, if only I had done this, maybe I'd have a better outcome now. Sure, you can always look back in life and second guess and live in regret. Say, oh, I should have, could have, would have done this. So you're focusing on what you feel is negative now instead of saying, well, hey, there's a lot of good going on with my life. And the reality is, if you would have done that other path, who knows? Maybe things would have gone worse. So I saw another hand. Yeah. So, yeah, no matter how many good things you do, I'm going to focus on the areas where you struggle, where you haven't succeeded. So in baseball, if I hit 300, what does that mean? Or if my batting average is 333, what does that mean to the layperson? Go ahead. Okay. Or specifically, I get on base, or I hit the ball and get on base a third of the time. Okay. Those of you who know baseball, is that a good average? How good of an average is that in baseball? Hall of Fame? Okay, so wait a minute. The Hall of Fame is reserved for who? Best of the best, right? So you're saying in baseball, I can fail two-thirds of the time and still be considered one of the best to ever play the game? But hey, man, you know, if I have my negativity bias, what am I going to focus on?
Two-thirds.
Well, that's great. You hit one-third of the pitches. But, man, you struck out two-thirds of the time. Way to go, loser. Like, okay, I'm just going to enjoy this going to Hall of Fame. Why are you calling me a loser? All right? So that's negativity bias. Focusing on the things in your life that are going wrong. Because, guys, everything is going to go wrong at some point. Or everyone is going to have something that goes wrong. Is probably more accurate to what I want to say. Today you've had things go wrong. Tomorrow you're going to have things go wrong. And I hate to break it to you. For the rest of your life, on a day-to-day basis, something will probably go wrong. Okay? But it's your choice to focus on those negative things or the positive things. So, if we don't want to be negative, we want to work on hunting the good stuff, it's going to lead us to some other good things. So, I'm very amazed about what's going to happen here. So, first of all, I'm going to have better health, better sleep. I'm going to feel more calm. How can being positive lead me to these three things, to better health, to feeling calm? What do you guys think?
Less stress in your life.
So, if I'm not focusing on all negative things all the time, you're saying I'm going to have less stress? So does stress not help you fall asleep? I know when I go to bed, I just stress as hard as I can about everything wrong in my life and eventually scream myself to sleep. You guys don't do that? Okay, never mind. Erase that part? No. Okay. So go ahead. So you have less stress. How does less stress benefit in these areas?
Well, you'll be more calm if you're stressing about less things, like things that you can't control, right?
Mm-hmm. Go ahead. Yeah, blood pressure, heart disease, all these things can lead to medical issues. I mean, and the thought affects our body. We all know this. And to your point, I'll come back to you. I know when I go to bed at night, like I zone out and I try and like take everything out of my mind and just shut off the world so I can be calm. Where if I'm stressing and focusing on the negative, yeah, it's going to be hard, man. I can't sleep. And you guys all know this. You guys have all sat there in bed at night and like your mind races. And you worry about what's going to happen tomorrow. Am I going to sleep through my alarm clock? That's the worst, right? Worrying about sleeping through alarm clock means that you stay up like an extra hour and then wake up an hour before your alarm clock. Pretty horrible, right? Go ahead.
I was going to say being positive definitely helps with a happy mindset. And, I mean, there's people that have cured themselves from cancer with a happy mindset, with a positive mindset.
It really is amazing. If you sit and start to do some research, the amount of people who have been able to be cured through different diseases just by changing mindsets and attitudes, you know, it's hard for science to even explain. But just the idea of feeling calm, man. Just chill out. You're much more mellow and easier to be around when you're not stressed out. Okay. Also going to have lower depression and greater life satisfaction. Those three from the first bullet kind of lead into the next one, right? If I'm not freaking out and I'm not stressing out, probably not going to be as depressed. If I sleep well at night and I'm real healthy and I'm calm all the time, you know, life's chill, man. I'm good. I'm living a good life. More optimal performance. Okay. Where can I have more optimal performance? I was running through this with my wife last night. She's like, in bed. I'm like, I don't know if I should say that. No, I'll say that here for sure, right? No performance anxiety, right? But legitimately, like in your business, in your, with your families, with whatever it is that you do, how can hunting the good stuff or focusing on good things help you perform better in your professions? So for those of you who could hear very well, the basic idea is you deal with a lot of people who make a lot of mistakes, and it's your job to correct those mistakes. And you're able to put a positive spin on it and say, you know what, it's easy to be frustrated by everyone else screwing up, but if they weren't screwing up, you might not have a job. So you're like, hey, job security, right? Which is why when I go to a movie theater, I take my full bucket of popcorn and throw it across the entire movie theater when I'm done. That way the people who clean up have something to do. Exactly. Like I'm contributing to the economy. Thank you very much. Okay. Now, what I just said probably doesn't help with relationships. And in fact, for some reason, I got a lot less second dates after I started doing that. But not everybody understands. All right. So you probably had better relationships with your coworkers. You probably get along better because you're like, hey, you know, we're all chill. We're not going to stress out about this stuff. If I can focus on positive things and not focus on negative things with my spouse, how is that going to improve my relationship? Spouse, parent, you know, direct coworker that I'm like a team member with. How does this affect that relationship? Go ahead. So you said assume positive intent, and that, if I understand, you're saying that, like, I'm going to assume that everyone else is intending to do good things, good work. Is that what you mean?
Yeah.
Well, I don't know. I do. It's like I fight that rage every day. Yeah, so the idea is if you focus on these good things, you don't assume that everyone wants to be a jerk to you. They're not waking up wanting to be, as you said, asshole. And it allows you to say, you know what? I'm sure he didn't mean to, like, completely blow me off or hurt my feelings or drop the ball on this. He probably intends to do the right thing, which allows you to be more forgiving and understanding with your coworkers. Is that kind of what you're saying? Yeah, absolutely. So I can hear you now. You guys are like, well, that's all great and everything. But you're all like, Staff Sergeant Miller, how do I do this? This crazy stuff you're talking about. This all sounds great in practice, but what the hell's going on? Well, patience, guys. I'll tell you. Okay, the Hunt the Good Stuff Journal. Now, this is the way the Army has asked us to do this. The Hunt the Good Stuff Journal, who knows what that is? Who can explain that to me? I know some of you are RTAs. I know some of you have been through this class before. Hunt the Good Stuff Journal. Use your deductive reasoning. He's asking me to hunt the good stuff in my life, and he wants me to use a journal to do it. It's a book that I keep. There you go. Easy. That was softball, right? Sorry, like patronizing you guys. So it's a book where I can write down positive things that happen in my life. Now, rather than just writing down things like a journal, like, today, Dorelli's hair looked nice, okay, as opposed to last drill, right? Just kidding. Ouch. I look worse than you do now.
I sat in the front.
Okay, so anyway, so this is how we're going to do it. We're going to write, like it said, actually, so will someone go ahead and read the very top bullet there, and then I'll read the one below it.
Record three good things each day. Next to each positive event that you list, write a reflection, at least one sentence about.
Okay, and for that thing, I'm going to write, hey, this is the good thing that happened, right? I saw Dorelli's hair today, and it made me feel so good. It's like, wow, he looks great. You know, maybe I could look like him. Does that make you feel better?
Yes.
Right? Okay. Such a handsome guy, right? So why did this good thing happen? So I can be like, well, I showed up at drill. And so did he. He showed up at drill, too. I got to look at him and say, wow, what a great guy. I had my eyes open, right? So I write that down. I showed up at drill. Number two, what this good thing means to you. Wow, what does it mean to me to see his amazing hair today? It's like it inspires me to know that maybe I could look as good as he does someday. You know, I know we're both a little bit, you know, a little bit overweight maybe, and our hair isn't great all the time. But hey, you know what? If he can pull it off, I know someday I can get there too. You're going to kill me afterwards, right? So what does the good thing mean to me? Yeah, there will be a boxing match after this, so stay tuned for that. Okay. Is medical on hand, by the way? I just worry for myself. Okay, next one. What can you do tomorrow to enable more of this good thing? Hey, I can come to drill the next day, and he'll be here then too, right? I should really stop doing this, or I'm going to get hurt. Okay, and then finally, what ways you or other people contribute to this good thing? So in many ways in our life, good things don't just magically happen to us. On occasion, we can get lucky. But there's a saying about right time, right place. Right uniform, right? We use that in the military. Right time, right place, right uniform. What does that mean? What's that?
Do the right thing.
Do the right thing, but more than just that, right? If you're doing the right thing, good things will happen to you. So it basically means that if I show up ready to do my job, good things can show up and happen to me. Okay, but I have to put myself in the situations where they can even happen in the first place. If I just sit in bed all day long, I'm like, I'm never going to see that beautiful mane of hair, right? So, all right. So those are the strategies, okay? So this is what we're going to do right now. We don't do this very much, but I want you to take between 5 to 7 minutes, it may turn into 2 to 3 minutes, who knows, and turn to someone next to you and sit down and say, just bring up one thing, okay? To the person next to you, say, what's one good thing that happened yesterday? And I want you to list, say, all right, well, I saw Dorelli's hair. Why is this a good thing that happened to me? And then rattle through that little list with each other. Let's go ahead and do it right now. 5 to 7 minutes. Turn to the person next to you. Ready, go. Okay, so how did that go, guys? I mean, hopefully some of you actually did it. I know a lot of times it's an excuse just to like, all right, let's talk about Guardians of the Galaxy or whatever. Right. Does anyone want to share? I would like two people to share kind of what they went over with their partner and kind of show everyone else kind of how you did it and how awesome you are. So I need two victims, volunteers. I'm not going to volunteer you. No, I want two people from two separate groups. You can be the same group, I don't care. But it's two people to share their stuff. So Ruiz, you guys want to do it? Okay, go ahead. Well, I mean, just by you even putting yourself in that position to get those, it allowed him to have more happiness in his life. So, I mean, there's a lot you can take out of that. That's awesome. Thank you. Hi, Ruiz.
Well, I started off with potatoes.
Always a losing decision.
Yes. That's a joke. Then, you know, we kept going. So, basically, I saw the negative stuff first. Like, you know, bad feel for the body, but it was good. It felt positive. It was good. Maybe later on it might not be so good, but it was just satisfying at the moment.
Almost guaranteed. Well, good. Hey, and that's the thing. The reality is, guys, no matter how shitty your day has been, I promise you there are good things that have come from it. I mean, like, even right now, right here, the fact that you're even sitting here means that you got up in the morning and you made it out of bed. You got here. Some people didn't and won't. Okay? You're in the military. You joined. You served. You've done all these things. You know, you're here. That's a success. Okay? There's always a win. Go ahead.
I guess I kind of go back to your third guy. Weekend. I work weekends and swings. My wife works Monday through Friday days, so we don't see each other a whole lot. So me being on drill weekend, well, guess what? I got off last night, and normally I'd be working. My wife has Saturday night off, so I got to hang out with my wife, which makes me happy, which makes her happy, you know? So even though, you know, a lot of people are like, crap, drill, the positive side is, well, I got the night off to hang out with my wife on a Friday night, which doesn't really happen that often.
No, I mean, that's a prime example.
Good thing for drill weekend.
Exactly. So there are positives, even though it's like you'd rather be doing something else, maybe, but there are still good things that are coming out of this. One thing that I remember talking to someone who had been through SEER school, and they talked about micro victories throughout SEER school. For those of you who have been or know anything about this, what am I talking about with a micro victory when you're in a situation like that? And for those of you who don't know, SEER school is where I'm going and playing prisoner of war. I'm getting beat up. I'm getting starved. I'm naked half the time. I'm getting hurt. It's simulating being a prisoner and trying to escape and evade. But how do I have micro victories in an environment like that? Go ahead. Absolutely, and I've heard similar stories to that. So were these micro victories in the situation, for those who didn't hear, it's something as simple as like, hey, you know what, I've been hosed down and wet all day, but now I'm dry. You know, I was outside in the cold all day, but they brought me inside, now I'm warm. Or discrediting or embarrassing the people who are your captors. The story I heard was about a guy who would, when he would walk with him, he would intentionally trip and stumble and fall to make the other guys around him, who were his captors, fall down. And he's like, you know, laying on the ground. And they like punch him and stuff, but he's like, hey, I still won. I got you. You know, so it's finding little ways to create victories, even in the worst sort of situations, okay? So let's go back to this. So I'm going to go ahead and read the, this is kind of a refresher here. I know we've been doing this a long time, right? So will someone go ahead and read the top bullet? Okay, yeah, so regular basis, right? And I want to say specifically those of you who have children, please do this. Please, please do this, okay? Those of us who've been here for a while and who've heard about some things that have happened recently understand how important it is to spend time with their kids and take the time to let them know what is good in their life. Because remember, the younger you are and the less perspective and less wisdom you have, the easier it is to feel like your entire world is crashing in and not understand that, man, things can get better. I took my son to his baseball game this morning, and I spent the entire drive there talking to him about, hey, man, right now, if something bad happens to you, it's your entire world. Like if a girl was mean to you that you liked or a friend bullies you, to you, that's everything because it's their capacity to feel. But, son, I got to tell you, things are going to get better. And I promise you, if you get through this, that's going to seem like nothing compared to what good you're going to have in your life. And we have to teach our children these things. We have to teach those soldiers of ours who are younger soldiers who are just coming in, and they're like, oh, it's the first time they've been chewed out by the sergeant major or whatever. They're like, oh, this is the worst thing ever. Man, you're going to get chewed out so many more times, this is nothing, right? But help people have perspective. Help people understand how to counteract that negativity bias, because in a lot of ways, man, it's life and death, okay? All right, next one. Someone go ahead and read optimism for me again. Okay, again, optimism. If I'm optimistic about my future, I'm not going to fall into focusing on these negative things. I'm never going to make extreme decisions like this. And hey, at the end of the day, my optimism level may even be too damn high, right? So that's a win. Okay, now, last thing I want to do here, kind of before we wrap up, I have a clip from Rick and Morty. Has anyone ever seen Rick and Morty in here? Okay, this will tell you a lot about my maturity level just by watching this clip. I want you to pay attention to some elements of this and figure out how this might help with resilience. Now, to set this up, they're watching a show where they have like interdimensional cable, where they have cable from all the different parallel realities, and anything that could happen does happen, and the show is just nonsensical. And what makes me laugh specifically about this one is they're kind of like, they're ad-libbing the commercials kind of as they go. You can tell like the guy's like stuttering over his words. It's pretty funny. So, but anyways, pay close attention, okay, because there'll be a test afterwards.
Huh, seems like TV from other dimensions has a somewhat looser feel to it.
Yeah, it's got an almost improvisational tone.
It's in theaters now, coming this summer.
Two brothers in a van.
And then a meteor hit, and they ran as fast as they could from giant cat monsters. And then a giant tornado came, and that's when things got knocked into 12th gear. A Mexican armada shows up with weapons made from tomatoes. And you better bet your bottom dollar that these two brothers know how to handle business. In Alien Invasion Tomato Monster Mexican Armada Brothers, who are just regular brothers running in a van from an asteroid and all sorts of things, the movie. Hold on, there's more. Old women are coming, and they're also in the movie, and they're gonna come and cross attack these two brothers. But let's get back to the brothers, because they have a strong bond. You don't want to know about it here, but I'll tell you one thing. The moon, it comes crashing into Earth, and what do you do then? It's two brothers, and they're gonna... It's called Two Brothers. Two Brothers.
What does that have to do anything with resilience? I gotta be honest, guys, it has absolutely nothing to do with anything. I just thought it was really funny. And for those of you who actually have an immature sense of humor like I do, at the end of the day, you can write that in your journal. Sergeant Miller showed a clip from Rick and Morty. All right, so what does all this mean? So let's go back to the bottom line here and kind of figure out what's good about this. Someone go ahead and read this bullet for me. Okay, we talked about this a little bit. One more time. How can I use what we've learned today, you know, jokes aside, to enhance my performance as a father, as a mother, as a boss, as a mentor? How can I use this to help enhance that performance?
It gives you a good idea of what to do to kind of replicate things, make your life better in the long run, when you're not just, you know, you look and you see, oh, this is a great thing that happened to me that I appreciated, and this is kind of why it happened. It gives you a better basis to have more of that good stuff happen in your life in the future.
Absolutely. So he said basically it helps you replicate the good things happening in your life. Because if you don't understand why you're winning, it's hard to replicate or to have a winning streak or to do it again. Okay, so we've talked about everything in the past from like shooting well in your rifle qualification or passing a fitness test or doing well on an exam. It's like if I don't know how I did well on my fitness test, how do I do better the next time? But if someone comes and says, hey man, you ran every day for 3 straight months. That's why you passed your run. Oh, okay. Well, now I know. I'm so right. So identify what led to the success, okay? Because again, other than rare occasions, good things don't just magically happen. You have to create them in your life, okay? Next, someone else.
How can keeping track of positive events and experiences affect how you interact with others?
Okay, how can it? So if I keep track of the good in my life, and I'll throw you a softball for this one, okay? If at the end of every day I go home and like I write down in my book all the positive interactions I had with my spouse, and I write only the good things that happened in here, how is that going to help enhance that relationship I have with my spouse? Absolutely. And you know, and I don't want to say excuse bad things that happen in life, okay? You know, there's plenty of time to work on problem solving and all that. There's a whole module about problem solving. But that's not what we're talking about here. We're talking about focusing on those good things. Because a lot of people who reach the end of their marriages, if you come back and you say, hey, you know, why did you guys get married in the first place? Sometimes they're like, man, I don't even know anymore. Like, I don't remember. It's been so bad for so long, I don't know what was good in the first place. So take the time to start writing this stuff down. Again, even if, and I know most of you, won't do this. I'm not under any illusions, right? I know that most of you guys are going to be like, yeah, no, that's a good idea. I'll never do it. But that's a good idea. Okay? But I promise you, if you go home at night, and specifically if you have kids or a spouse or someone that you work with or live with on a close basis that struggles with anxiety or fear or catastrophizing their problems, start writing things down and keep a journal to show a record. My wife has started a business on eBay. She's doing like reselling stuff. She'll like buy a used item and resell it for more. She'll have bad days where she doesn't make any sales. And when she's having a bad day, I'm like, babe, look at your past 30 days. Like, look what your average is. Yeah, today you didn't sell anything. 2 weeks ago, you sold $300 worth of stuff. Okay? It's all about that perspective, keeping it in perspective. And then even in the darkest of days, there are silver linings, okay? At the end of the day, guys, I want you to be Optimus Primes, not Negatrons. Okay. All right, so this is the normal check on learning slide, you know, the how I do it, what's the skill, what, that's too much writing. That's way too much information. I'm not going to make you do that, okay? But hopefully you get the idea. Hunt the good stuff. I focus on the good things in my life. How do I do it? Well, at the end of the day, I sit down and I write down. Even if I don't write it down, I at least verbalize it. We do this in the Army. It's called AARs, okay? What worked and why did it work? You know, we talk about what didn't work and how we can make it better, but we always make sure we focus on the good things that happened, okay? All right, you guys think you got it? Okay, make sense? Please, please, do this tonight. Even if you just do this one night, go home tonight, take the time with your spouse, your kids, call your mom up if you live alone, go to grab your roommate, be like, hey, Sergeant Miller told me it's an order, I have to do this stuff, okay? Yeah, go ahead and do that tonight, please, okay? And I would appreciate if you came back to me tomorrow and let me know how it went, okay? You know, don't all, I know all of you guys will be coming to my office at the exact same time, everyone's going to be bunched and like, oh, Sergeant Miller, I want to tell you what I did. But, you know, spread it out throughout the day tomorrow, okay? But come tell me how it went. Okay, again, that's all I have. The quick favor for me again, if you enjoy what I do and you think that I can help other people that you know or that you love or that you care about, hop on my stupid little Facebook page, like the page, and share it with someone if you think it can help them. Thanks a lot, guys. Have the rest of a great drill weekend. Bye-bye.